I made this 32 feet, and 35 feet would probably be even better. But another thing I've done is keeping your cordage more intact. When you roll your cordage up, I'm using what's called a fireman's coil, and that just keeps everything from getting tangled up, or it's supposed to. So we'll unwrap this here, and I'll show you what I do. Now, after we do this demonstration, if you want to learn some of the knots I'm showing you, we'll have a little hands-on, and you can try to, you know, learn some of these knots here. Now, what was I saying about not being tangled up?
It's almost like Spider-Man.
It has.
This never happens until the camera's rolling. Oh, come on.
Look at that.
How many of you guys like to just use a tarp and strictly tarp and hammock stuff?
I'm a convert now.
Yeah, I like that tarp you got set up over there, Manland.
The condo.
What is that, like 18 feet long or something?
It's a Fred's Dollar Store original.
You like Fred's Dollar Store, don't
yes,
you?
Yes, sir. And it was highly incorrectly marked.
Highly incorrectly marked.
Yes, it originally was supposed to have been, I think, a 12 by 9. And it ended up being 100 foot by, 100 foot.
It looks like 100 foot. We ain't gonna do the fireman's coil no more.
And first time in, he's come a long way in here.
You could tell by the tarp.
I think we're getting somewhere. Fine. Now all that part, you guys that are filming, you can edit that out, please. Gotta make it look good on film.
You can trust me. You know I'll take care of that.
Yeah, that's what I'm afraid of. Anyway. Now what kind of, some of you guys use those straps, those nylon straps.
Tree hugger.
Tree huggers? Yeah. And that's all nice, but I like to keep my mind fresh with the old school stuff, because sometimes that stuff breaks and all you have is some quarters to deal with. And a lot of people today don't know how to tie very many knots. The longest time I knew how to tie my shoes, and that was about it. So what we've got here on the end of this, again, this is my ridge line, and it's green. It's 32 feet to make the span. In the end of this, I have put a bowline knot. And we'll show you how to do that afterwards if you want to learn that. And that's just a loop, a secure loop. We're going to go around this tree here. Speaking of tree hugger.
What you do when you got short arms? All that tree
you love. Tie a rock to the end of it and sling it around.
Or you can bring a wheel.
Yeah, I was just having a moment there. Feeling the love. So I run this around the tree, and I run it through the loop, and then I just cinch this down. I get it up about the height that I want it. I bring this over here, I pull it this way, it's good and secure. Come over this tree. Running the cordage around this tree. And this is where we're going to put a trucker's hitch in here. Make a little loop. Run the cordage back up through here. And have a loop. You want to make this loop a couple, 3 feet out, depending on what kind of cordage. This is paracord and it does stretch, so you need to bring your loop out a little bit. What this does is allow high pitches are very simple to do. And that'll hold that good secure. And after you stretch it, you can retighten it if you need to. Then we throw our tarp over here. And this is a breeze, no pun intended. I might need a hand to hold this in the wind here. I got that son. Someone grab this other side. He'd never met me before, and we got to talking about it. He said, you know, I thought you, so you had that big beard and everything doing that demonstration.
No, you had on the hat and the vest. And
I had my hat on, yeah, my newsboy cap, which I wear when it gets cold enough. It's too hot for a hat right now. He said, I thought you some kind of bushcraft celebrity, some kind of bushcraft fancy pants.
I was afraid to talk to him.
I didn't know who he was. All right. If that will stay, we're going to do an A-frame configuration today. Now these other pieces of cord are obviously orange. These are for my guy lines to guy out the points on my spark. So we have the green one and the orange one. And we have these camo ones. And how this color coordination works is when I reach in that bag and grab the dark green cord, I know that that is my ridge line. So I know what I'm reaching for. It makes it easy, especially in low light situations, or if you're in a hurry, instead of going through your quarters like I did at the beginning of this, you know. But with that color coordination, it helps you put up your tarp quicker, and makes it easier for you. Now you don't have to use orange or green, you can get any color you want. So I chose orange because I have a tendency to trip over my guy lines. So orange helps me see them. And I still trip over. Now what we're going to do with this, on this side, I'm going to run a what's called a round turn and two half hitches. We're going to secure this corner with that. Round turn, two half hitches. Make a pretty sturdy knot. It's not a secure enough knot to support your weight or anything like that, but it's more than secure enough to tie down a tarp or something. With this other one, I'm going to use a just a stopper knot. And I'm not going to tie it to the tarp, actually. I'm just going to run it through. We're going to make a stopper knot and run it through the grommet. And this technique here, instead of using the round turn and two half hitches, which you have to go back later and untie off the tarp when you put it away, with this one, it'll hold the tarp very secure, but when you're done, you just pull it out. Throw it, fold it, roll it up, put it in the bag. And I like to use that technique as well. That's going to be our guy line. Now, to keep your tarp stretched out good and tight, you need to use some other cordage for that. And this is my camo color cordage. I've got five of them. I've got four that I use and one for a spare. But I'm just going to use two right now. We're going to do with a type of a prussic knot or a prussic knot, depending on what part of the country you come from, you pronounce it different. I've heard it called everything. And I'll demonstrate this after this as well. But what this does I call these my drop leaders, and I form a prussic knot up here with these danglers here, and I run these through my grommets. And if your tarp has tie-out points, you can run these through the tie-out points and do the same thing that you can in the grommet. And I just put a stopper knot in this as well. Now these pieces of cordage here are all 2 feet long. And I don't know if I mentioned about the orange ones there. This is 32 foot. My orange ones are all 10 feet exactly. These are 2 feet. And we're going to do another dropper here. And these prussic knots are very easy to do. And I'll show you what they do. What these prussic knots do, like most knots, they work by friction. And this prussic knot, you can slide this thing up and down the cordage. But when you put a lateral pull on it, once you get it snugged up good, you put a lateral pull, it holds very strongly either direction. But it's also easy to slide. So I put this through my cord, through my tarp. Run me another stopper knot here. Nice stopper knot that won't go through the grommet. Then I can adjust this tarp however I need it. And I can center. If I need to move my tarp over, I just bring this down this way. Bring it this way, or if I need to go the other way. And this, pull on that a little bit, and you've got a nice tight ridge line, tight tarp. Now, you come out here, we're going to pull this out. About right there. I found that with a square tarp like this, if I splay my lines out on the corners out, it keeps the center part sagging as much. Assistant!
How about you done? With
you're not getting a raise this year. Would you drive that peg in over? Oh, look at that. Now, right here we're going to do what's called a taut line hitch. And it's very similar to a prussic knot, but a little bit different. Get that smoked up. And this works very similar to those knots up there. You can pull this up, tension that, or loosen it, or tighten it back up. Get it however tight you need it.
I don't need that.
Well, that's why I'm doing the demonstration.
I need to get loose this.
After this demonstration, we're all going to go over and do some karaoke, right?
Sure.
I hear them over there.
Talent show.
Is that a talent show? Hey, Bushcrafter's got talent.
Music.
They got something where I want. They got a 4 AM with
me. Oh, yeah? Okay, so I'm not going to do the backside, but you get the gist, the whole point of how this works. The main thing that... The unique thing about the way I set my tarp up is the cordage system. with the color coordinated cordage and the specific lengths of cordage. So if you know what kind of tarp you're going to use, and you can use any kind of tarp, it can be steel nylon, canvas, whatever, or cheap Walmart plastic tarp, like Van, like cheap Walmart plastic tarp. But this is the way I do it, and the reason I do it this way is because I had such trouble with my cordage and finding the right length of pieces. I just had this mixed bag of cordage in all the same color. So I did it this way, and that just makes it really easy to do, very quick to do. And as you can see, it just took a few minutes to get this set up, and a couple more minutes I would have the backside done, stretched out. And I like to do it this way. One thing with these prospect knots, you can adjust your tarp all the way along your ridge line, wherever you need to get it. And with the, instead of using the, what do you call them, you got the ratchety, or the adjustable things on your, dog bones. If you don't have any of that, just the tarp and cordage will do the trick. If you know a couple simple knots, like the crochet knot, the taut line hitch, and you can set up a really nice tarp system that's good and tight, sheds water, sheds a lot of wind, and you'll be good to go. So that's what I wanted to show you. And I have four of these, one for each corner. And these other orange ones are all, these are all 3 feet right here. There's four of them in this roll. If I'm doing this where I have this backside on the ground and I don't need 10 feet of cordage to stretch out like this, I'll just use the short ones on the backside. And I keep four pegs in here. Very lightweight aluminum pegs. But if I need to put a couple more tie out, I can carve some pegs from, you know, a tree branch laying on the ground, make extra pegs if I need them. So I have enough cordage to do this and a little couple spare pieces of cordage. So that's my tarp set up. That's what I wanted to show you. And if you want to do some hands-on after this, then you're more than welcome to. So that's that, and that's my demonstration, and I appreciate y'all coming out.
All travel hammock. What I want to do is, they're light and handy, but the way that I put mine up is with these paracord. Now what I've done is, I've taken a 20 foot length of paracord, I've doubled it in half, and then every 6 or 8 inches I tied a knot. Okay? Allows me to go up to the tree, throw it over the tree, go through any loop it lines up to, pull it, and cinch it up tight, one pull. Done with it. You walk away from it. It won't fall off the tree. Now.
Yeah, I can do it.
You want your ropes about, 10 high usually. You got to remember the lay of the land around you. So if this ground is uneven or one tree's higher than another, you got to kind of play with it. Plus, when you're setting up a hammock, you want your head higher than your feet, at least an inch or two. Otherwise, you wake up with that headache because all the blood's running to your head. Now, if you go to hook one of these up, you get up here and your space isn't quite right or whatever. Let's say you've hooked it like this. You want a little bit of slack. You do not want it pulled blood tight, because when it is, that's when you get the shoulder squeezed in a hammock. You want it a little bit loose. If it's not the right angle, try elevating it a little bit higher so it sags a little bit more in the middle. Some people are more comfortable that way. But we've got it. Now, suppose I need to bring it tighter and these snap hooks are not in the right place. What you do is you just take the whole cord and go through it. Come up here to any of these knots, go through, and then pull it like a trucker's hitch. And you can cinch it up as tight as you need, just like that. Then just pull down here and re-hook it or half hitch it off. Either one will work. Very quick, very easy. Now, since I'm not going to be the one sleeping in this, we have to make sure that she can get in and out of it. Where you at? Come on, guinea pig. See if you can get in and out of it. You do know how to get in and out of a hammock, right?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead. Okay.
Shorty.
Okay, now try and get to see. Now, putting an underquilt. when you're laying in the hammock, as you can see, you're in full contact with the body. What's happening is your body heat, and you're the source of all the heat. No blanket or quilt generates any heat. You're making the heat. Go ahead and lay down. You are the guinea pig. Lay down. This heat is directly being transferred through the material, and you're heating the air on the other side of the hammock. So anything between you and the hammock is being crushed. You're losing that insulation. I want to put a layer on the outside to capture that heat. But this is not a flat bed. Notice how a hammock comes up to a point on either end? Heat flows uphill. So as that warm air is generated right here, it will naturally flow up toward the point. So I've got to have something that's going to be relatively tight up here at the top, not just hanging around it to capture that air. Otherwise, the heat's just going to flow away from me. I'm losing BTUs. Okay, now get out. I'll put on the underquilt. A cheap poor man's way of putting underquilt on is using a poncho liner, sometimes called a wooby. Now, I only need this extra warmth, really, from the top of my head to about in the middle of my thigh. My feet don't matter. But I need this area right here to keep my core temperature solid. So, depending on how wide you are, you can either use the poncho liner the sideways, or you may have to do it doubled in half the lengthways. We're going to do it the sideways right now. And if you notice, it's got tie-outs on the corners and tie-outs in the middle. What we're going to do here is we're going to take that, fold it in half, come underneath the hammock, and this hammock has a rope right here. I'm going to bring both cords up through that, and I'm going to just go around, bring them back to the top, and do a simple bow knot. Something I can get out easily. Now, I grab the edges. Make sure I got the right edge here. There's the point. Okay. I'll come all the way down here. Now I've got that center tie out again, and my two end tie outs. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to take these two sides, do a simple half hitch over it, and I'm going to bring them over the top and take the center tie out and loosely tie it about, you know, 2 or 3 inches from the end, like this. Now, what this has done is created a pocket. You see how it wants to slide up? Now you want to take some cord and come from the bottom and just make a loose hook to it. Not blood tight, but just a little loose hook. This is going to become important in a minute. Now, I want it loose. I want it baggy enough when I get in this and it sags down, I'm in this. And not it blood tight and I can't lay down. But at the same time, I don't want it hanging so far down. So you may have to adjust for length or width or etc. Okay? Now, oh guinea pig.
Vanna.
Did you just call me Vanna?
Okay, now notice this is in the way. You need to sit down in it and then scoot your legs in it. Okay? Just like that. Now lay down. Now notice how it's cupping around the body. This loose tab, I simply take it, and if I like to sleep with my head to the right, fold it underneath, pull it out up here on the right. Now the full length has two layers of this on it. Now you recently saw Dave Canterbury do a video where he was talking about taking a blanket and coming from underneath the whole thing like this. And taking one end and tucking under, and then taking the other end and throwing it over, and this would be the way it works. Do we see a problem? The end of the hammock is wide open. Remember that heat flowing uphill? There's nothing here capturing the heat. So this doesn't work. If, however, you want to use another one of these Wubies as the blanket, here's what you do. Again, now you're going to take it lengthways. You're going to fold it in half. Take the middle. Take all three ends, bring them together like this. And you're going to tie this end into a knot. Just roll the thing underneath and tie it tight, making a pocket, which is a lot easier to do when people ain't looking at you.
Hey, Colin.
Hello, I'm busy.
Man, man's not available.
This is going to make a pocket. If you've got a small sleeping bag, what you want to do is take this sleeping bag and turn it upside down. Stick your feet in the hole and put your, what would be the back of the thing, over you. Now, I've created that pocket. You're going to pull it up on you, stick it through here, take your toe and hook it, and stick your feet in it. Now you pull this up on you and you tuck it down inside the hammock on either side of you. Now you're completely covered. Your vitals and all your warm areas are insulated and trapping heat. Your feet are wrapped up in two layers, sometimes more, trapping the heat this way. If you put a good heat reflector through your back and a small heat reflector in the front, you get even more of a warmth. Now during the winter, I drop mine down right down on the ground so I'm just barely floating. And I'm gonna pack pine straw underneath the full length. I mean, I want it bushy underneath me. It does two things. It traps the air and it gives me a ready source of emergency fire starter, because I'm gonna build my fire right there with a heat reflector. My tarp is gonna be coming up to a low ridge line and it's gonna be coming down 2 or 3 feet this way. This traps the heat coming in. It makes it circle around like this, like I'm in a rotisserie or something. I want the wind coming from this direction or that direction. I do not want the wind coming from my back or from that side, because you form a draft and the smoke does this. I don't want the smoke, I want the heat. So I want the wind flowing through, across the front, either way of my camp. So now I've got the heat, I've got the insulation, and I've got everything I need covered. You want to go one step higher, take an emergency space blanket and lace it through those grommets on the hammock, on the poncho liner, and put that hanging on the outside of this. Now I've got a thermal barrier as well. It'll sweat you out. So now as my body heats and it goes through the hammock, it's trapped in these double layers. That heat then radiates right back to me because it spreads out from my kidneys and my lower back. I carry a Nalgene canteen. It'll take boiling water. It's bad bone chilling cold. Last thing I do at night is fill it full of boiling water. That goes between my legs as a hot water bottle. I'll be good till in the morning. Any questions? Okay, that's it, guys. Thank you.
Nice job, Lee.
Thank you.
Yesterday I made those awesome, what do you call them? I make them, I don't know what they call them. Corn fritters, yeah.
There you go.
All right, thank you guys, I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
Okay, we're going to do a demonstration of panic over here.